Hello, it's Keith here, and this is the first in the series of the Grime 6502 videos. Now, if you remember, Grime Z80 was a project I did earlier in the year where I made the old DOS game Grime on 11 different Z80 systems, and this time I'm doing the same on 9 6502 systems. So today's the first day. I got up at 6 o'clock in the morning and started programming, and it's now 1:30 in the afternoon, and I'm doing today's video. As soon as the video is uploaded, I will then start programming and working on tomorrow's video. So that's kind of my programming schedule, and that makes it easy for me to get to a clean position where all the systems are working nicely and I can upload a video a day quite easily. So I just wanted to let you know how it is I schedule my time during this project. So, what have I done today? Well, I was starting from a very simple Hello World example, which had a basic bitmap being drawn to the screen, and that was my sort of template that worked on all of the systems. So the first stage for today's programming was to convert that into a tile routine, which could do the same tiles as I did on my Z80 version of the program. So, of course, I have the same bitmaps as before, and here they are. So I'm going to be using the same bitmaps as I did for Grime Z80, because there's no sense rewriting them. For some reason, one of the colours has gone pink here, but never mind. So this is what I'm going to be using for Grime 6502 and 68000 as well. I will redraw them in some cases, but I'll get to that in a moment. So I've got my bitmaps. First thing was to convert them to the correct formats. My sprite editor has had a lot of upgrades over the last months, adding new exporters for all of the systems I'm going to be working with today and over this series of programming episodes. So most of the work today has been on this simple tile command. As I said before, I'm mimicking the same commands with the same functionality as I did on the Z80 system. Firstly, this makes my job easier, but also if you're looking to follow these videos for educational purposes, you can compare the systems very easily because they should be as close as possible to each other. So, the first thing I think I should explain about my programming style with regards to 6502 is as follows. Now, if you're not familiar with 6502, unlike Z80, it doesn't have very many registers. It has only basically three registers. But what it can do is it can use the first 256 bytes of system memory as what's called the zero page or the direct page. And you can use these kind of like registers. So because of my Z80 roots, what I tend to do is I tend to use some of these to emulate Z80 registers. So you'll see here I'm using a D and an E as if they're a register. And you'll see H and L and things as well around the place. And so if you look at my Z80 code, you should see H and L registers on the Z80 system are being used the same as the ZH and ZL registers in this version wherever possible. So again, it should make it easier for you, and of course it also makes it easier for me because I'm going to be switching between three programming languages in the future, 6502, 68000 and Z80, and I've got to try and make things as easy as possible for me wherever I can. Also as part of that, I've defined these basic functions commands, which are macros and also calls, which can emulate, again, Z80 commands like the LDAR command here and INC of register pairs or direct page pairs. I'm going to go over how all of this works in my 6502 tutorials, which are going to start in January next year. So just bear with me at the moment. If you don't know how 6502 works, please just watch these and enjoy the sort of ride of trying to program the systems. And we'll explain how the 6502 actual code works very early next year, literally starting in January. So back to simple tile. Well, the functionality is virtually identical to the old version that was in Grime Z80 because that's the whole point of it. So there's a couple of versions of the code. There's a tile-based version for the hardware tile systems like the Nintendo NES. There's a BBC version for the vertical systems like the BBC. These are ones that work in 8x8 squares. So you have to, when you plot 8 bytes to the screen memory, they actually go down vertically and then it moves across. Whereas on a normal system like the Amstrad CPC, you'll be constantly going across. So it's this kind of vertical zigzag kind of pattern on the BBC. And then you've got the normal bitmap as well. Now in both the BBC and the normal bitmap case, I need to work out where the data is for the tile in memory. So I do that here. But then when it comes to the normal bitmap, I have to plot the pixels to the screen, obviously working in an XY pattern until the tile is drawn. And then there's an alternate version for the BBC. And essentially it's just slightly different. Because there's no horizontal and vertical, there's just a sort of vertical drawing procedure. It's slightly easier, but let's say basically the same. And so really there's not so much there. A lot of the work is being done by this get VDP screen pos command. And there is a different version for this on all of my systems. Again, this is something I'm going to be covering in my tutorials later. like here's the Super Nintendo version, and this is programming the Super Nintendo VDP to select the correct memory location for a change in the tile map. So again, all that's going to be covered in specific tutorials down the road. But for today, I had some of this code already, but there's bugs in it, there's bits that aren't efficient enough, there's inconsistencies, and I'm fixing those as I go along with Grime 6502. And that was really the whole point of doing Grime 6502. It was to not just write the game, but it was also to say, right, well, my code is now sufficiently solid to be able to produce a simple program quickly and reliably. So hopefully we're going to get all the bugs out and the game will be open source, so everyone will be able to learn from it with any luck. So again, as I say, get VDP pos is doing most of the work to get the actual memory location to write to. These are the write commands for the various systems here, and then you've just got the bitmap ones for a screen in system memory. So what have we got here then? Well, let's actually have a look at what we're doing then. So here you can see a very simple test on the Super Nintendo. So we've got the upwards tile here, which is tile 1, and then we've got this blob here, which is tile 8. We're just drawing them to two positions on the screen. But that's not very impressive really, is it? So let's see something a little bit better. Now if I just re-enable this repaint screen command and then I run this again, you can see we're drawing in the Grime Z80 title screen. Now I should point out, the code that's drawing this is not complete yet. The proper Grime Z80 code was drawing based on two screen buffers, and it was comparing the two, and it was only drawing the bits of the screen buffer that needed to be updated. This version is not at that stage yet. So what it's actually doing is I've pasted in the binary data of the screen of the Grime Z80 title screen here. I've padded it out to 32 because that's what the screen buffer was expecting. And I'm just using it as a dummy screen buffer at the moment. So that's why you've got some corruption at the bottom and things, but it does work. And as part of this, firstly, I had to complete that simple tile command, which took me, two thirds of the day, shall we say. And then as well as that, I've converted repaint screen and do fill with some exceptions here, because as I say, it's not complete. And find tile, which works out the memory position of the tile within the tile map. Of course, that title screen in this case, because there is no tile map yet. And then it just puts it to the screen. So that's the Super Nintendo version. Well, let's see another system then. Well, let's start from the right at the top. Let's see the Atari 5200. So there you go. You can see it's very small because that's the way the emulator works. But we have got a Grime Z80 logo, so that's obviously working okay. I'm not going to do the Atari 800, it's the same system. There's virtually no hardware difference, just a few ports are different on it. So the Apple II, now there's an interesting problem on this version. Now, you'll notice every other line is an alternate colour. Why has that happened? Well, it's quite strange and I can't fully explain it, but basically the Apple II's colours are an artifact of the CRT display of the TV, basically. And it's kind of like the interference is causing colours. I think it's something like that. It's a bit beyond my experience, so I can't properly explain it. But basically, every alternate byte, you have to flip the bits over to get the same colour. So I haven't done that. And so it's had the effect of every other line is a different colour. So basically, I need to do either some bit shifting or two versions of my tile to allow the colours to be correct depending on the position. So I need to have a play with that, but it's fixable. It's just early days. But anyway, you can see the Grime Z80 logo is drawing okay there. And here's the BBC, and we've got a nice Grime Z80 logo there, so that's okay. Now, the Grime Z80 logo is a bit corrupted here and there's some weird colours. The reason for that is I'm not setting the colour map yet, but basically it works. I thought that was enough for today's progress. So, you know, I was quite happy with that, just getting that onto the screen. Now you will notice I'm using four color mode here, and I'm actually halving the width of the tiles in four color mode. So rather than being 8 pixels wide, they are 4 pixels wide. So they're the same physical dimensions. I don't know if that's the right choice or not. I'm sure some people would prefer me to use two color mode, but I'm not a fan of two color systems because it tends to make it quite difficult. With Grime 6502 it would work, but I want to use the core code of Grime 6502 and Grime Z80 for a bigger project in the future, and I don't want to be limited to just two colours for that. Now the Atari Lynx. We get an error message here because the Lynx cartridges use encryption. I'm not using it, so you get a warning here and things. It's not a problem though. So here you can see the Lynx screen is so small the Grime logo doesn't fit. I mean, I hope you can see this okay. I'm getting some visual flickering here because of the emulator, but maybe I should do smaller 4x4 pixel sprites or something. I'm not really sure. I'm not too much of a fan of that because it will make it harder to maintain. But anyway, we'll see how it goes. I mean, it looks okay anyway. It's certainly functioning fine. We're going to skip the NES because the NES does have a problem, which I'll discuss at the end. The glorious PC Engine here. Looking quite nice here, but slightly odd colours, but never mind. Not quite why they're blue on colours. The Super Nintendo. We've already seen the Super Nintendo, haven't we? Anyway, it's working fine. The Humble Vic 20, which is my lowest specification system, but as you can see, it's working reasonably okay. You see there's some corruption on the left-hand side of the screen here. I may be wrong, but I think that's actually just the colour map. The loading text at the start, I think, has actually set the colours to blank, and so when I'm writing my sprites over the top, nothing's appearing. I may be wrong on that, but as I say, I think that's just a colour map problem, and it's nothing more serious at this stage, so hopefully we can get that fixed pretty trivially. Now on to the NES. The NES is the big problem one. Although actually, the problem with the NES is also a problem with the Super Nintendo, but it's not as bad a problem. Now, you can see something happening there. You probably saw the basic sprites come past, and now we're seeing the full tire maps are kind of drawing in. But something crazy is going on. And what is it? Well, on the NES, you can only draw to the tile map during the V-blank while the screen is not drawing. Now, ideally, you need to use an interrupt to do this, but in my test code, I've not been doing that. I've been just cheating and making a pause until V-blank is present. It also messes up the scroll position, which is why you saw things going crazy there. So the drawing to the screen and the tile map is working. However, I'm doing it in a very crude way, which is totally inadequate for a real system. So what I think I need to do next is I need to create a buffer within the system memory. And that's no minor feat on its own, because the system has very little memory to start with. It's only got 2K of memory, I think. I need to create a buffer in there of the tile map, and then I need to copy that into the proper screen memory during the V-blank so that that doesn't happen. But I've not got the code to do that yet, so as soon as I finish this video and get it uploaded, that's what I'm going to start on. I said it's also a problem with the Super Nintendo, because that's right, the Super Nintendo has the same problem. It's just the Super Nintendo is so fast I can actually get away with it, and it doesn't have that scrolling reset problem, so I'm getting away with it, but it's not good enough. I really need to do better, otherwise this NES version is going to be slower than everything else, which is going to be silly. Anyway, but you can see there's been some reasonable progress today. I'm going to start working on a few of those bugs and glitches. Hopefully, I'll be able to get the proper tile maps working in RAM so that the difference bits are being detected. Maybe I can get the colour maps in tomorrow as well. And hopefully, we'll have a proper screen display by then without all this corruption, maybe. Anyway, that's about all for today. It's been quite busy. Obviously, most of this code has had to be rewritten over and over again for all the different systems, because relatively little of it was sort of cross-platform. But it looks all like it's going pretty well. So if you're following me on Patreon, the next video will be uploaded tomorrow. If you're on YouTube, it will be uploaded in a week's time. Either way, I hope you'll join me, and we'll see how Grime 6502 looks next time. Thanks for watching, and goodbye.